My name is Richard Trevor Martin. I was born on the 15th of March 1923 in Malvern in Victoria, Australia. When the war started, all of us young people were then expected to be turning up for and joining the different services, the Army, the Air Force. At the age of 17, I decided I'd put an application in for the Royal Australian Air Force. And subsequently, I got a letter back saying that thank you for your application, but the entry age for the Air Force is 18 years, so if you wish to reapply when you turn 18. But in the meantime, the Army had started to take in all the young 18-year-olds. They had to all register because Japan had entered the war, and all the young 18-year-olds and above were all supposed to register, which I did duly registered. And in due course, on the 5th of February 1943, I had received a call up, like so many other young men, to attend the hall at Cogra in New South Wales to be interviewed and for the Army. So the next thing I'm told, you're going to go up, you're going to be sent up to Cobar for a quartermaster's course. And the date happened to be that I got on the train to go to Cobar was the day that the Japanese submarines came into Sydney Harbour. And that caused a bit of confusion, but of course we didn't know the news up at Cobar until a day or two later of what had happened. I was in the Army for 6.5 months, and then I got a call from the Air Force. I was to report to the Air Force, learning all about the Air Force and doing your marching and all that sort of business. I thought I might become a pilot because my coordination was fairly good. It was above average, but they must have thought your coordination would be better being an air gunner, wireless air gunner. So that was the job that I was allocated to. At the end of February in 43, and I was then a sergeant, and you said, right, you're on embarkation leave now. Said goodbye to the family, which was early in the morning, and they're all in bed, of course, and I'm up, dressed, ready to go, catch the train to go to Bradfield Park, and that was the last I saw of them for quite a while. So we all loaded on board that ship, and as soon as we were all on board, we were the only ones that was going to take. And the ship started to move away from the wharf and move down the river. And of course, during the course down the river, they started to play White Christmas. And of course, that brought a few tears to the boys, especially me. I know I had tears in my eyes, because I was saying goodbye to Australia. And of course, we didn't know if we were going to ever come back again. I'm dreaming of a white Christmas. They had a number of the pilots, navigators, radio operators, and all this. Well, they were all told, now get out there and get yourselves all crewed up. So the pilots come, they get the first, you know, they pick out who they want, the navigator, you would like to be with me, radio operator, bombardier, and all that, and then they eventually come back to, they pick the gunners up last. They picked me up, one of the group picked me up, I made the fourth Aussie in the crew. And so, that was the crew that we started with as flying in Wellington bombers. Of course, the Wellington was the main aircraft that the crews were started on up there until they learnt enough and then could be transferred over to usually the four-engine heavies like the Lancasters and Stirlings and all, Halifaxes and all that. The next day I was in bed, and the boys from my crew called in to see how I was, and they said, "How are you today? We've got to go out again today to do what we didn't finish yesterday. Are you okay to come with us?" And I said, "Oh look, I just can't get out of bed and start dressing and come with you. You'll have to go and see the doctor or the whoever's in charge and just see what's what." So they come back a little while later and said, "No, you've got to stay in bed here. So we'll have to go and borrow somebody as our rear gunner, and we'll see you tomorrow then." Well, tomorrow never came for them. They went out that night and they crashed into the ocean. And so that was rather a distressing point, because they were a decent lot of people, boys and that. And after I was grounded, they completed two operations, and on the fifth operation, they were shot down coming back from the target. And the pilot realised that they weren't going to make it, they wouldn't make it across the channel, so it was best that they all bail out over Europe. So he gave the order to bail out, and of course the two gunners, with nothing much else to do, they arranged to get out fairly quickly, the rear gun and the mid-upper. And then the flight engineer, he came down the back and got out the side, the big side door of the aircraft. While the four officers up the front, the pilot held the aircraft as much as he could level so that everyone could bail out. And the officers went through, there was a trap door in the floor of the front section of the aircraft where the front crew could go straight through, you know. So they donned their parachutes and went through the door on the floor of the front of the aircraft. So everyone got out safely out of the aircraft before it crashed. Yeah, so that was, I was there until the end of the war, really, in headquarters in London, yeah, so. I met my wife in Sydney, we got married and we built our home, and my wife, of course, she was unfortunate, couldn't have any children herself, nor could her sister. As soon as they discovered she had leukemia, she lasted for 3 weeks and was gone. So I haven't had a wife ever since. No, I was just happy to do my part. I mean, it might not have been as great as I really intended, but you know, in the flying side of things, but I was very lucky, as I say, I was very lucky to come home again, really, and like so many of the boys that went over, they just didn't come back, which was very sad. But I was very lucky that I came back, and I appreciate that, and that's why I try to, you know, do the best I can for the boys that are left that come in here and all that sort of thing. And I was just thankful that I was able to come home again, really. I was very fortunate. I must say I've had a very fortunate life.